social problems and design more effective solution. So for example, if unemployment, what can we do to overcome the issue to help prepare for other career. Okay, you will discover a wide range of career deal with economic issue on many level. Okay, or to become an economist. Okay, develop a body of knowledge that could lead you to become an economist in future. So okay, don't be surprised. Okay, as an engineer, okay, you might end up maybe okay set up policy for government. Who knows? Even though you are engineers, okay, you can also becoming an expert and also can help the government with the set up the policy for the growth of economy in our country. Okay, and this is the additional information, and this is the macro and micro economics. I explained this before. Okay. Okay, and this is also the same. Okay, why study economics? Okay, so next we move to this supply and demand. Supply and demand. Okay, ada soalan so far? Bagian pertama, introduction. Any question so far?
Tak ada, doktor.
Ada. Okay, so kita sambung okay, to the next part that is on the supply and demand. So this is a video YouTube. Okay, it's about 10 minutes. Okay, so okay, you boleh buka after class okay, or during your free time. Okay, go through this video. Okay, and this also on the revenue, profit and price. Okay, and the cost of production. Okay, and this is the fundamental concept of demand, supply and price. Okay, so kita kena faham. So normally the price okay being controlled by the demand and supply. Okay, so it is the fundamental concept of economics, and it is a backbone of a market economy. So demand it can be fluctuate depending on the, for example, product that you want to buy. So demand is how much quantity of product service is desired by the buyers. So the quantity demand is the amount of the product people are willing to buy at certain price. The relationship between the price and quantity demand is known as the demand relationship. And supply is how much market can offer. So berapa banyak that the product is available in the market. So the quantity supply refer to the amount of a good producer are willing to supply when receiving a certain price. So the correlation between the price and how much of a good or service is supplied to the market is known as the supply relationship. Okay, so relationship between the demand and supply underlie the force behind the allocation of the resource. So in the market economy theory, demand and supply will allocate resource in the most efficient way. Okay, so that so kita kena tahu so the supply and demand. So that's why in some cases sometimes the peniaga dia sorok certain item so to get the price higher. So that basically is against the law. So dia so that's why government sometimes they have enforcement activity so that they must make sure the supply of certain product in the market is at the optimal level. If it's low and the demand is high, they will investigate and maybe there are certain activities by certain section of business that maybe they hide the stock in order to increase the price. So that's is the basic. Okay, so this is the law of demand. So kita tengok kat sini demand A, B, C. So the demand schedule for an individual specific of unit of good and service that the individual is willing to and able to purchase at alternative price during a given period of time. So at different quantity, okay, we have a different pricing. So as the quantity getting higher, okay, and the price is getting lower. So the relationship, the price and the quantity is inverse. More units are purchased at lower price because of the substitution effect, okay, and income effect. And this is the law of supply. So supply, supply relationship, Q1, Q2, Q3. So the supply curve normally has a upward slope, indicating producer must receive higher price for increased output due to the principle of increasing cost. So this is the law of supply. Then we have an equilibrium of the supply and demand. So this where it intersect, that is the equilibrium. So equilibrium occur at the intersection of the market supply and demand. So at this point, quantity demand equals quantity supply. So the quantity that individual are willing to purchase exactly equal the quantity producer that are willing to supply. Okay, so surplus exit at high price higher than the equilibrium since the quantity demand fall for short of quantity supply, and at price lower than equilibrium price, okay, there is a shortage output since quantity demanded excess the quantity supply. So that is the equilibrium price and quantity. So this is the equilibrium steady state. Okay, so that is the point for allocation of good at the most efficient. Okay, so this is okay, and this is the price movement. Okay, so price movement. Okay, for example, you reduce the price, the demand will increase. So this is a strategy. Sometimes the business use. So they will drop the price, so that it will attract the consumer to buy. So for example, sale okay, at the shopping mall. So sometimes they will have year-end sale, for example, or during festive season, Chinese New Year, Hari Raya, Diwali. Okay, so they can have this sale. So getting cheaper, few percent, maybe 20-30% or even 70%. So when price reduce, and okay, people will come, okay, and consider to purchase that particular item. Okay, so that is the case, and or reduce the price in the market, and supply demand share decrease. Discounted item due to the low demand. So this also another factor. So certain item, okay, is difficult to get people to buy. So sometimes they have put it at the lower price just to persuade people to buy. So that also create the price movement. And also this is the price shift. So the price it can shift due to the shift in term of the demand or the supply. So when one of these variable change, okay, there is a change in demand, okay, and therefore shift the demand curve. So the market demand shift up to the right, okay, when there's the increased preference for commodity, okay, and when the price substitute commodity rise, okay, and the price of a complement goods decline. So there are the market supply curve shift when number size of producer changes, factor price, wage, interest, rent paid to the economy resource, cost of material changes, technological progress, okay, or other government subsidies, okay, or tax output. So these are the factors that influence the shift in the demand. So it can shift, okay, and lead to the shift in the price as well. Okay, so this is the second part section. This on the price, demand, and supply. Okay, okay. So that is the second section. Okay. Okay, next kita masuk to the next part. So this is on the monopoly, oligopoly and perfect competition. So apa yang kamu faham monopoly ni? Monopoly ni apa? What is a monopoly? Apa monopoly? Anybody? Pernah main game monopoly?
Pernah.
Pernah. Lagi? Apa kamu faham monopoly?
Macam menguasai.
Macam apa?
Menguasai.
Yes, maknanya you control, you control, so you menguasai, so dalam business, okay, monopoly means, for example, only one company, they sell that, provide that particular product or service. So monopoly, atau ekonomi, tak bagus, so dalam agama pun, kalau kita belajar dalam Islam pun, okay, monopoly, you should avoid lah, sebab dia akan menyebabkan dia akan memeras pengguna, so it's not good into from the economic perspective, also from Islamic perspective also is not good, dia memeras pengguna, so people won't have much option but to buy from that particular supplier or particular company, but in some cases later I will explain, sometimes it's difficult to have more than one company, but we must also accept that the fact sometimes in some cases monopoly exists, for example kat Malaysia, for example electricity, so only for example Tenaga Nasional that supply the electricity, because of the cost, for example for the power plant and so on, so that we have no choice but to accept that under that condition, this monopoly, so okay, we will go through this monopoly, oligopoly and perfect competition, so this is the market structure, so you can have a monopoly, like your friends mentioned just now, one producer seller for a product in the market, it is an industry by itself, no substitute. Okay, reason, high cost, so macam katalah Tenaga Nasional, okay, TNB, they supply the electricity, okay, the cost for power generation expensive, so we have no choice, but luckily because it is under GLC, government link company, so the government can still control TNB, so if they decide to increase the tariff, so the government still have the right to mention to control the price, as long as it won't burden the consumer, so okay, if that is fine, or exclusive right patent, so kalau kamu boleh buat ubat, so for example COVID-19, okay, for example you are the company that will be able to produce particular vaccine, for example COVID-19, so no other company in the world, so you end up as a monopoly, so you have the right towards that particular vaccine, so that's so it is a sole proprietary, so it is patented under for example your company name, so that's the reason why you can have monopoly, oligopoly, okay, only a few firm make up and industry, so they control over the price, okay, and still has a high barrier to entry, barrier to entry adalah halangan untuk memasuki ke dalam pasaran perniagaan tertentu, so if you want to enter for example airline industry kat Malaysia, okay, so you want to set up an airline, so only a few player for in Malaysia, so sometimes it is difficult. Okay, product are offered nearly identical and independent due to the market forces. So in this case they give example of telecommunication, okay, Celcom, Maxis, Digi, or even like mentioned airline industry, kita ada Malaysia Airline, Malindo, AirAsia, Firefly, this only controlled by certain company. And this is the perfect competition. So there are many buyers, sellers. Okay, many products similar in nature. Less barrier to enter for a new company. Okay, and price are determined by supply and demand. Competitive market subject to the price determine. So for example, kalau tengok supermarket kedai jual barang keperluan kita ada Giant, Tesco, Aeon, or even kedai runcit so this kedai runcit so they are anywhere in Malaysia so basically they can compete easily. Okay, and they have their own strategy to attract people to come, okay, and buy the product at their place. So that is the perfect competition. So this is the three market structure. So with the best is to have this perfect competition. So because it will benefit the consumer, and people will have more option. Okay, and they have a lot of choice. Okay, they can make the best decision for themselves. So this is the market structure. I think I've explained just now. Okay, can read. So this is the characteristic. So perfect competition, oligopoly, monopoly. And contest, tebal. Market okay, so this is the characteristic, okay, monopoly and anti-competitive market so this is the video, okay, you can go through this video later, okay, so this is the market structure, monopoly, oligopoly and perfect competition so this is the explanation about the monopoly So it's a refer to the market structure where single firm control the entire market. So the firm has the highest level of the market power as consumer don't have any alternative. So monopolies often reduce output to increase the price and earn more profit. So sometimes that's where sometimes in this case in Malaysia the government played important role. So sometimes they have to control and they have to maybe have discussion with the company so that it won't burden the consumer. So these are assumption that you made when you talk about monopoly. So monopolies maximize profit. You can set the price. Okay, there are high barriers to entry and exit. Okay, and there's only one firm that dominate the market. Okay, so that is the issue. Okay, so we try to avoid. And this is a oligopoly. So oligopoly, only 3 or 5 dominant firm. So it's still not as bad as monopoly, but people have a few choices. Maybe 3, 4 or 5 company that provide the service. So that is the oligopoly. Okay, and this is the perfect competition. So this is you give, okay, there are a lot of company, small big firm, okay, in the market, and people have the choice to make decision where they want to buy or where they want to get the service. Okay. Okay, so ada soalan, any question so far? Ada soalan ke berkaitan oligopoly, monopoly? Okay, perfect competition. Clear?
Clear.
Okay, so next kita pergi kepada this section. That is on the GNI, GDP, GNP, gross nation. Product, gross domestic product. Okay, so what is GDP? So maybe we try to have a look at this. Dengar.
What is gross domestic product, otherwise known as GDP? Gross domestic product is the market value of all finished goods and services produced within a country in a year. Think about the economy like a giant supermarket filled with millions of goods like dresses and washing machines and services like dog walking and massages. Every time a finished good or service is sold, we ring up the price. At the end of the year, we ring up the total. That's the GDP. Let's look more closely at some of the details. Notice that we said GDP is the market value of all finished goods and services. A finished good or service is one that will not be sold again as part of some other good. When a bakery buys flour, eggs, and butter, we don't count these sales in GDP because these goods aren't finished. They are intermediate goods that, when combined, will become a finished good, a cake, for example. But if a consumer buys an egg to make an omelet, the egg is a finished good because it won't be sold again as part of some other good. In other words, our GDP supermarket is like a real supermarket. At the GDP register, we ring up the eggs sold to consumers and the cakes, but we don't ring up the eggs the baker used to make the cake. There are also goods that are used to make other goods but are still considered finished goods. These are called capital goods. If Caterpillar produces a tractor and sells it to a farm, the tractor is considered a finished good. The tractor is finished and its value is added to the GDP. Although the tractor is used to make other goods, it won't be sold again as part of another good. So the tractor is still a finished good. The GDP is the market value of all finished goods and services produced within a country in a year. GDP only counts production. If an old house is sold this year, that doesn't add to GDP since the house wasn't produced this year. Only the sale of new houses add to GDP. GDP also only counts goods and services produced within a country. If you buy a bottle of wine imported from France, that adds to France's GDP, not to US GDP. On the other hand, a computer produced in the United States and exported to France adds to the US GDP. Let's go back to the definition one more time to see some of the limits of GDP as a measure of economic production. GDP is the market value of all finished goods and services produced within a country in a year. If a good isn't bought and sold in a market, then it's not typically counted in GDP. Why not? Counting the market value of, say, all the breakfast cereal produced in the US is easy, at least in principle. Just add up the price every time a box of cereal was sold. Since market prices are observable, every statistician who counts carefully will come up with pretty much the same number. But without market prices, there's no easy or agreed-upon way to calculate how much a good is worth. Polar bears, for example, aren't counted in GDP. The statisticians and economists who calculate GDP have nothing against polar bears. The problem is that there's no easy way to calculate how valuable polar bears are. Just because GDP doesn't include polar bears doesn't mean that we can't love polar bears. And if polar bears were included in GDP, that wouldn't require us to love polar bears either. Ultimately, GDP is just a number, but it's a useful number. In the next few videos, we'll show how the GDP number can be used as a measure of the standard of living. But for that, we'll have to make a distinction between the nominal GDP, what we have just discussed so far, and real GDP. So stay tuned.
Okay, so that is the video, short video on GDP. Okay, so let's stated mentioned in the video. Okay, GDP, okay, or GNP, gross national product, equal the total value of goods services produced added to the value of income received from other nation. So in the total payment made to the foreign nation is deducted from the production and income. So it's the output, goods services, expenditure, household, government, okay, and the income measure, profit and wages. So all three are positive. GDP means the country economy is growing. Yeah. So if negative, is the opposite. Okay, and two consecutive 3 month period of contraction means the country is in recession, or known as a technical recession. And so, okay, so this data normally will provided. Okay, it will be provided by Bank Negara. Okay, so they will make this announcement. Normally. And so they will state the GDP of our country. So if positive means fine, the economy is growing, people are spending their money, okay, the business are doing well. If negative is opposite, so you have two consecutive, so it fall under the category of a technical recession. So means that the government should be aware. Okay, and start to take action and measure to counter this problem or issue. Okay, and GDP, gross domestic product, is the best way to measure country's economy. So it's a total value of everything produced by the people and companies in the country. Okay, it doesn't matter if they are citizen or foreign owned company. If they are located within the country boundaries, the government count their production as GDP. So that's why it is important to have investors coming to our country to attract investors. So when investor come, they set up a factory plant, they produce the product in our country, then being sell being sold in our country or being export to other country. So it is included as part of a GDP calculation. So that's important to have these investors to be in our country. So that's the reason why we can see before COVID the Prime Minister, okay, they go to the overseas, go to China, go to India, go to Europe, go to the US, okay, to everywhere around the world. They try to get these investors come set up business, okay, and also at the same time offer job opportunity for our local. So you as a, for example, potential graduate, when a company set up plan, so you, there's a possibility you might end up working in with the company. So at the same time, you also contribute towards the growth of the GDP for Malaysia. And the only exception is the shadow or black economy. So black economy means the business that is done illegally. Okay, so there's smuggling, for example. So this is a illegal activity. So this is will affect the GDP. So how that GDP affects you? So it can be from the government spending, business investment, personal consumption. So kita pergi kedai, you go to the shop, buy items, so directly you also contributing towards the GDP. Okay, and also export. So that's why we need to become a exporter, negara yang mengeksport barang. So when we export, like it shows in the video, for example, US produce computer. Okay, export to France, when person in France buy, so it will contribute to the GDP in the US. So that's how does this export activity can help to grow the nation economy. Okay, so this is the GDP, gross domestic product. So this is the component, personal consumption expenditure, business investment, government spending, okay, export minus import, okay, so that is how to calculate the GDP. What it tells you about the economy, the different major GDP are great tools, comparing economy of other countries, and as how an economy change over time, okay, when they talk about the size and economy, they are referring to the GDP, okay. So in 2007, US lost the position as the world largest economy. So nowadays, okay, they are competing between US, China, Japan. So this considered superpower for the economy nowadays with China. So with the population, okay, and lot of potential. So okay, they become might be the world largest economy. So the growth rate measure whether the economy is growing more quickly more slowly than before. Okay, if the producer less than the quarter before, it contracts and the growth is negative. So this is signal of recession. If we don't, the government don't take action, it can end up turn into the depression. So that is the bad thing that could happen. Okay, and the ideal growth rate is between 2 or 3%. So that is the GDP. Okay. So this is the how GDP affects you. Okay, so the GDP impact personal finance, investment, job growth. Investor look at the growth rate to decide if they should adjust their asset allocation. They should also compare the country growth rate to decide the best opportunity. Okay, and investor like to purchase share of a company that are rapidly growing. In the rapidly growing countries, so it could affect the decision by the investors. So sometimes investors decide to enter because of this GDP, and they might leave. So the investors business, okay, they can come and leave. So I think we can see some of company that already set up in Malaysia, they decide to terminate their operation. Okay, and move to another country. So this could also give impact to the nation economy. Okay, and the Federal Reserve use growth rate to decide whether to implement expansionary monetary policy to ward off recession, contraction monetary policy to prevent inflation. It is primarily true for the federal funds rate. So this is in the US. Kalau kat Malaysia, we have a central bank, bank negara. So bank negara will decide what the next action if the GDP data is not that good. Okay, and also the growth rate speeding up. So they can raise the interest rate. Okay, and they can lock either fixed rate mortgage. Okay, if a growth slow down or negative, then you should that's off your resume. So slow economic growth usually lead to layoff and unemployment. So that is the bad thing that could happen. Okay, so this is the GDP. So these are the factors that influence GDP. So human resource, sumber manusia. Okay, the quality available human resource can directly affect the growth of economy. The quality of human resource depends skill, creative abilities, training, education. So the human resource of a country is well skilled, trained, then the output would be of high quality. Okay, and a shortage skill labor hampers the growth of economy, whereas surplus of labor is lesser significant to the economy. Growth. So when you talk about human resource, so you cannot run away from talking about education, pendidikan. So that's the important part that shape the quality of the human resource in the country. So that's where now okay, the school university is very critical. So that they make sure that, for example, the syllabus, okay, they are cater produced towards requirement. For example, nowadays towards IR 4.0. So that's the important of having this right education with a proper syllabus. Proper approach from there we can produce quality graduates that or quality workers that could meet the needs in the market. Second is the natural resource. So affect the economic growth to large extent. So it can be the resource, water supply, okay, land, okay, or natural. For example, oil, gas, minerals. So that's also important. But not necessarily the main reason. That can influence the GDP. Because some country they don't have natural resource. They don't have oil. They don't have gas. But still, they can have a good GDP. Okay, what are example of countries with less with no resource but they have a quite good GDP? Contoh, example. What are example? Give me example of country yang ada tak ada sumber tapi dia punya GDP, dia ekonomi dia bagus. Contoh, anybody? Anyone? Ya, Singapore. Macam kamu-kamu kata, Muhammad Aris kata Singapore. Kalau kita tengok Singapore, sebuah negara yang tidak ada sumber, sumber macam kita ada minyak, we have gas, we have minerals before this, oil. But Singapore is a country, even water, they had a problem before. They have to rely the supply from Malaysia, but now with the use of technology, for example, they managed to get source of water, for example, from new water, okay, or desalination of the seawater. They try to get diversified the source of the water. But Singapore, okay, macam kawan-kamu kata, okay, it is a country without resource, but it's one of the largest GDP, because it's the financial center, pusat kewangan for this Southeast Asia, okay, and also they have a lot of R&D activity, so a lot of investors go to Singapore, set up business, and they have a business friendly policy, business friendly policy, so that investor come, okay, they can set up a business and then they can run the activity smoothly, so less red tape, less bureaucracy, bureaucratic. So that these are the elements that attract investor to come. Ada dari Singapore, contoh Korea, South Korea. Okay, South Korea also is a country with no resource, there is no oil, okay, no mineral. But they come up as one of giant economy. So they have Samsung. Samsung. They have Hyundai. They have Kia. So this product, LG. Okay. So it's all over the world. So they sell through all over the world. I think some of you use some Samsung smartphone. So this indirectly you also contributing to the GDP in Korea, for example. So other than that, Japan. So Japan is another country with no resource, but good GDP, because of innovation, the ability to innovate product and so on. So the second part, natural resource, is good, but it shows that it's not the really the main factor that influence GDP. Even you don't have natural resource, okay, but if you have a good human resource, okay, and also support the government from the government policy, as well as the ability to innovate, you can grow the economy and become one of the superpower in the in terms of the economy in the world. Okay, C is the capital formation. So land, building, machinery, power, transportation, media, communication. So producing, acquiring all these man-made product in terms of the capital formation, increase availability capital per worker, okay, and further increase capital labor ratio. So consequently, the labor increase, which ultimately result in the increased output, growth of the economy. And technological development, technological development. So that's another factors, important factor. So application scientific method, production technique. Okay, technology defined as a nature and type technical instrument. So it helps increasing productivity with limited amount of resource. So they work in field of technological development grow rapid compared to countries less focused technological development. Okay, select the right technology and play important role of the growth of the economy. So technological development penting get the right technology. Okay, nowadays I 4.0 like I mentioned. Okay, so that is another aspect help to do, grow the economy. And last is on the social and political factor. So play economic growth of country. So custom, tradition, values, belief contribute to the growth of the economy to a considerable extent. So stability of the social, the citizen, the people in the country, they live in harmony. Okay, less or no riot, for example, rusuhan, tak ada rusuhan. So that's good factors and politik, negara stabil, that's also important. So if you can reduce fighting among the politician, so we can provide more stability to the nation. Okay, and we can focus on running the business, running the economy rather than end up fighting among the politician, for example. So that that's the good thing if you can achieve that. So these are the factors that influence the GDP. So this is the another video GNI, Gross National Income. So this is the comparison. Okay, so this is another video. I think you can have a look at this. Okay. Okay, so this is the additional reading. Okay, so this is GNI comparison chart. Okay. Okay, so this is the GDP Malaysia. Okay, so you can see the chart fluctuate from 2000 to 2009. So okay, so there are factors that cause fluctuation. So that the what happened. Okay, and this is the GDP output, GDP in Malaysia. Okay, so the data provide. So this it can be used for improvement, for example, from the government, be used by the investor to evaluate a decision whether to enter or whether to exit the operation in Malaysia. So they can use. Okay, and this is the GDP, okay, 2016, okay, 2014. Okay, so this is the data. So you can get this information okay from Bank Negara. Okay, lot of authority or MIDA, MIDA Matrade, they will generate this information, they will update this information from time to time, so you can have a look at this. Okay, so this is another department statistic. So department statistic, jabatan statistik, so you can get the information about the economic growth. Okay. Okay, so so far ada soalan berkaitan dengan GDP. Okay, okay ke semua? Any question? Ada yang tak clear ke berkaitan dengan GDP? Okay, so itu berkaitan dengan GDP. Next kita masuk on tax, percukaian. Okay, so benda yang I don't think most anybody likes, semua orang kalau boleh tak suka cukai, tapi nak tak nak, whether or not we have to pay tax, so that the government has income, they have money to run the country, so whether we like it or not, we have to pay tax. So that's okay. Some you all student, you kena bayar cukai ke? Ada ke bayar cukai? Ada ke tak bayar cukai? Betul ke tak ada? Kalau pergi makan KFC, kena bayar cukai ke? Makan KFC ke McDonald's ke fast food ke, ada kena bayar cukai?
Ada.
Ada kan? You have to pay tax. Okay, kalau tu, kalau buka kamu dapat receipt, makan kat KFC, McDonald's, Pizza Hut, cuba tengok kat bawah tu berapa persen cukai dia kenakan. Okay, 6%, few ringgit. Okay, that you have to pay. Atau you beli tiket kapal terbang, you have to pay airport tax. Or when you renew you punya motosikal, road tax, kenderaan, you have to pay tax. As a student, so kamu dah start bayar. But when you graduate, you work, you will pay more tax. Kamu akan bayar lagi banyak cukai. So we cannot avoid. Tax is part of our responsibility to the nation. So that the government have money to provide education to improve the school, okay, to build new hospital or to improve the existing facility. So that these are some of the benefit that given back to the people. So that through the tax that being paid. So we look at the definition tax. Tax definition, contribution levied on person, property or business for the support of government. So kita bayar, bayar kepada lembaga hasil dalam negeri. So they are the one who collect the tax. Then from the tax, the government will decide okay what to do with the money. So that's where they table budget. For example, last month, the government table budget, they give the allocation. So how many percent for health, how many percent for the roads, how many percent for university, UiTM for example. Okay, so these are being table. So if once the budget pass next year, okay, the money will go for example to UiTM. So that hopefully by that time COVID, the condition is getting better, okay, we can run our normal activity as usual. So that is the definition. So law cases, a compulsory exaction of money by the public authority for public purpose, enforceable by law. Raising money for the purpose of the government by means of contribution from individual person. So it's an amount of money which taken from your earning to help towards someone of the cost of service we receive in this country. So this is the purpose of tax, cukai, revenue, ensuring stable growth in revenue to finance the annual budget, growth, provide incentive within the tax system to promote growth in the private sector. Okay, so these are tax in Malaysia. Okay, direct tax, indirect tax. Okay, so paid directly to whom it being levied. So macam saya jadi pensyarah, saya kena bayar cukai pendapatan. So that's being deducted automatically from my salary every month. So kalau RPGT, real property gain tax, kamu beli rumah, after that you sell. So the amount of profit that you get from that sell of the property is being taxed. Stamp duty pun cukai, and petroleum income tax or indirect tax. Yang ni yang kamu bayar ni collected via third party. Macam saya katalah pergi makan fast food, Pizza Hut, McDonald's, KFC. Okay, dia ada sales tax, service tax. Okay, and GST. So GST ni dah tak ada. So we not sure the direction. Maybe it might be reintroduced back. So okay, we just wait from the announcement from the government. Okay, so characteristic of income, regularity, Okay, income distinguished from a saving. Okay, income must be received. Customary receipt are not income. Illegality is no relevant to assess ability. Okay, speculation is not income. So kalau kamu ada speculation, you expect, for example, ada rumah, expect it will go. For example, up to 1 million. So you speculate. So that is not income. Reward for service. So if you do certain things and you get reward, is also income. Give is not an income. So bila kamu kahwin nanti, dapat apa dah, duit hantaran daripada pihak lelaki, itu bukan income. So it is not taxable. So dapat berapa banyak pun, is not an income. So class of income, income can be from business, gain profit from business, employment, gain profit from employment, dividend, interest, discount, rent, royalty. So kalau kamu sewa rumah, okay, so hasil dapat sewa rumah, okay, also is taxable. Okay, pension, annuities, or other periodical payment, okay, gain or profit. Okay, apa yang keuntungan yang di perolehi. So this is the intangible income. Okay, so this is income. Okay, why do you have tax? Is the main source of federal, state, local government, revenue, pay for building, public education, highway, airplane, road sign, salary of government employees. So large amount of tax revenue are raised from levies, personal income, including investment income. So the federal income tax is structured to tax different level of income tax on gradual increasing scale. So that's why we pay the tax. So it's from the government, okay, and okay, the give back to the people who need it. Okay, so why do you have tax? Okay, only without government there would be no tax. But therefore, without tax there would be no government. So it's a way that the government can raise money to pay this provide this facilities, okay, to the people or to help the less fortunate or poor people. That's why we have this tax. Okay, so this is also the same. Okay, so this is additional, and this is the in Malaysia. So if you want to know more, you can go to this website, Lembaga Hasil Dalam Negeri, LHDN, negeri. So this is tax system in Malaysia, individual tax. Okay, so tax based for resident, okay, allowable deduction, or tax credit. So we will go later. So macam kalau kerja, so for me, in my case, every year before 30th April, I must submit the tax form. So now we can use e-filing. So e-filing, so I will fill in the form and declare my income. Okay, and I will get this tax relief. Sebagai contoh, kalau individu boleh dapat 9,000. So kalau perubatan, kalau mak ayah ada ambil perubatan, we can claim this. Okay, and or we can have this education. So kalau anak dah besar, belajar dekat universiti, okay, I can claim this 7,000 for example. Okay, and also lifestyle. So contohnya beli personal computer, smartphone, you can claim this 2,500. But important thing, whenever you claim, you must make sure that you keep the receipt, because maybe LHDN will call you. They want to confirm what you claim is betul lah. So make sure that you keep the this receipt in the case that you're being called to provide this evidence. So these are the claim relief that you can get. So kalau kamu beli insurance, you buy insurance, you also can get this tax relief. Okay, tax relief. So it be deducted from your salary. So after deduct, so bila potong, you will get this income tax rate. So it will be apa dah, jumlah pendapatan yang dicukai, chargeable income. So kalau tolak, okay, for example, you get katalah okay, 56,000 cukai kena cukai. So the first 50,000, okay, it is 14%, okay, then the balance, okay, so it is another percentage yang dicukaikan. So kamu kena bayar lah, sebagai contoh, 2,000, betul lah, taxable income, your taxable income is 2,800. Okay, so normally when you work, okay, from January to December, so when you receive your payslip, okay, LHDN will deduct automatically certain amount of your salary, maybe 300-400 ringgit every month. So for example 300 dipotong, so kalau 12 bulan maknanya 3,600. So when you submit your form, for example next year, okay, for example you have to pay 2,800 sebagai contoh cukai, kan. So you have excess about 800, so that excess 800, they will give it back to you, so kamu akan dapat balik duit tu. So normally it's fast, so you submit in April, okay, normally by May, within 1 month you will get back that excess 800 ringgit into your account. So this is e-filing, so bila kamu kerja, okay, you normally your employer will help you to register your income tax, then you will can access using your IC number and your password. So this is the start. This is on the infographic on the tax. Okay, so this is the tax system in Malaysia. So this for just now I show is for individual. So this is for business. Business. So you can have a corporate tax. So corporate tax 24%. So normally this corporate tax, the government can make changes. Okay, normally it is announced during budget. So this November, okay, the government, if they want to reduce, for example, the corporate tax, so they can announce, and normally they will announce during the budget. So when they announce, it can be one of factors that attract the investors to come to Malaysia. Okay, so this is the tax system, corporate tax. Okay, so capital gain tax. Okay, capital gain tax. Okay, so this is the tax system. Okay, compare to other country in the world. Okay, so this is the income tax assessment. So ni yang saya dah nyatakan tadi lah. So you can get tax relief. Okay, and okay, so that's also another infographic. Okay, so this, okay, insurance pendidikan perubatan. So if you buy insurance, health insurance, you can claim. You boleh claim. So that's the good thing. So better get insurance lah. My advice, because nowadays we don't know what will happen. Sekarang banyak orang muda pun sakit apa semua. Okay, so you get insurance, it might help you when you get treatment. So that's okay. And this is the real property gain tax and stamp duty. Okay, so if you purchase a property in Malaysia, you'll be subject to real property gain tax when you sell it. So RPGT is a tax on the profit gain from the sale of the property, and it's payable to the IRB, Inland Revenue Board, and will vary depending on the amount of the time you have owned the property. Okay, so kalau kamu beli rumah, before this, before 2018, sebelum before this, if you buy a property that you sell less than 5 years, you will be subjected to RPGT. But after 5 years, you don't have to pay RPGT. But after 2018, when the change of government, that time government, they introduce also after 5 years, you have to pay also RPGT. So that is what you have to do. When you sell the house after 10 years, you will be still have to pay the RPGT. Stamp duty. If you buy a property in Malaysia, you will also need to pay stamp duty, which a tax that is levied on the legal recognition of the SMP agreement and loan agreement when you buy a house. Okay, you can calculate the stamp duty that you will owe to other property on the government. So kalau kamu beli rumah nanti, okay, kamu kena bayar stamp duty. So katalah kamu punya rumah harga katalah setengah juta. Okay, so first 100,000, 1%. So meaning is 1,000. Then the next 400,000, 2%. So is 2% of 400,000 lebih kurang 8,000. So 8,000 plus 1,000, that you have to pay about 9,000. Bayar kepada lembaga hasil dalam negeri. Okay, so if you buy a property, harga rumah tu 1 juta sebagai contoh, you need to pay stamp duty for transfer of 24,000 ringgit. So banyak lah. So bila beli rumah, okay, you need to consider. So this stamp duty, it will based on the market value of the house. So kalau katalah kamu beli rumah daripada mak ayah, katalah rumah tu harga 1 juta, but since you buy from family, katalah you beli pada harga 200,000 sebagai contoh. Okay, but when it comes to stamp duty, you will have to pay, for example this case 24,000. You kena bayar 24,000 ke lembaga hasil negeri. It's not the amount that you selling price, it's the market value of the property. That you must be aware, kena tahu. So don't be surprised, jangan ingat you just bayar pada harga jual 200,000. Okay, and this is the RPGT. So this infographic is the old one. So macam saya katakan before 2018, you don't have to pay, but since after election 2018, that time the government they change the policy. After 6 years, you still have to pay the RPGT. So it depend on the government decision at that point. So this is the property transaction cost in Malaysia. So next is the road tax. So ni semua orang bayar. So semua orang yang ada kenderaan, tuan punya kena bayar. So it depend on the engine capacity. So siapa pakai kereta 1,000 dan ke bawah, untung RM20. You just need to pay RM20. But as the engine capacity getting bigger, you have to pay more in terms of the road tax. So that's is normal lah. Kamu kena you have to pay. So normally you renew road tax dekat JPJ, road transport department, or you can do it at post office, or you can do it online guna service available online to pay the road tax. So this is the tax system in Malaysia. So this is on the consumption tax, GST. Okay, GST, okay, is another issue when it was introduced in 2015. So this is also is another issue compared to SST. So GST, okay, so the government at that time decide 6% of goods service tax, but also they can give exemption exemption on certain item. So keperluan sebagai contoh kalau kamu at that time you go to Tesco Giant, buy rice, fish, meat, chicken, cooking oil, fresh vegetable, or when you buy for baby, Pampers, formula, milk, okay, so it is exempted from paying GST. It's a 0% GST, so that is being excluded. So that's is on the consumption tax, GST. Okay, so it is a single stage tax imposed, taxable good, local and import. So you need to register with the custom authority, charge and collect the tax from the customer. Okay, so this is the tax system in Malaysia, GST. So this is a comparison, SST, GST. Okay, it's a narrow tax base. Okay, so cascading compounding index. Okay, no complete relief for export. Okay, export are zero rated, eligible to claim input tax. One good thing about GST is the input tax. Sebab dia ada input tax. Bila when you buy, bila kamu beli barang daripada supplier, okay, you will have an input tax. But when you jual, when you sell to the customer, you will pay output tax. And when you sell, you can claim back the input tax that you have paid. That's the good thing. So bila ada terjadi macam tu, maknanya it's difficult for macam dekat awal kelas, we talk about black economy, benda-benda penyeludupan. So bagi contoh, kalau kamu ada kedai, baiki kereta, so you beli katalah bagi contoh 100 unit tayar, you buy 100 unit of tayar, okay, so you pay input tax for that 100 unit tayar. But for example, after you buy, the customer buy, you sell to the customer, you manage to sell 50 unit, for example. So that 50 unit, you sell, you pay the output tax, means that you can claim the input tax. So means that there is another 50 unit remaining in the store. So from there, custom dia boleh monitor, they can monitor. So they can monitor, for example, after you sell, you purchase another 100 unit. So the authority, they can question what happened to the 50 unit that you haven't sold. Kamu tak jual. So from there, they can control the activity, black economy, benda-benda illegal, penyelundupan semua. Okay, it's difficult under this GST. So that's the advantage of having GST for this input tax. So tax at multi-stage address the issue of transfer pricing and vertical integration. Okay, and increase tax productivity. So means that GST difficult untuk orang nak menipu. Okay, and we can control the economy. We can reduce black economy. So that is the good thing through this input and output tax. So this is the video SST GST. Okay, and this is a lot of this being issue over since 2015. Okay, okay, so this is the SST impact. Okay, so SST dikenakan from the manufacturer to the wholesaler 10%. Okay, so okay, kalau tengok GST, okay, it is retailer to the end user. Okay, 6%. So in between, dikenakan juga 6%, but you can reclaim the input tax. So that is advantage. Okay, so this is SST, GST. Okay, this is the comparison. So you can read it. Okay, so this is GST, SST. Which one is better? Okay, so okay, so nowadays okay, there's been another issue kalau baca surat khabar ke, okay, that the government might reconsider bringing back GST. So okay, we just wait and see what happen. Okay, ada soalan Ada soalan ke so far? Any question? Ada soalan nak tanya berkaitan dengan cukai?
Ada.
Ha? Tak ada? Any question? Tak ada?
Ada.
Tak ada. So, saya ingat kita bagi break kejap lah. Bagi break. Sekarang 11.38. Okay. 11.45 kita sambung balik lah. For the second part lah. Second part lah. On this lecture. Okay. Okay, have a break first.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, so semua ready? Okay, kita boleh sambung eh? Okay, so kita sambung the second section on this engineering economy eh. Okay, engineering economy, this is part on the inflation, recession and productivity eh. So productivity, so kalau kita tengok inflation ni apa? Apa itu inflasi? Inflasi ni apa? Anybody?
Penurunan.
Penurunan. Inflasi ni kenaikan harga eh. Kenaikan harga. Kalau kita tengok inflation, okay, increase of price or it costs more to purchase the same item. So money inflation increase in money supply, the currency is losing its purchasing power and increase of the item or service price. Itu yang kita maksudkan inflasi, maknanya kenaikan harga. Okay, so kalau kita tengok from this infographic okay, 1978 2012, so during that time in 70s average basic salary for example 1100 okay, and now 8 years ago about 2500 So at that time in 1970s if you go to Taman Tun Dr. Ismail PTDI in KL, okay, you can buy a house two story 62,000 so 62,000 bukan contoh pada tahun 1978 Okay, now kalau kita tahu kalau kat KL Taman Tun Dr. Ismail I think this kind of house is worth okay about 1 million so after almost 40 years nowadays that house is worth about 1 million okay at that time 70s okay can purchase Opel 12,400 okay but now you want to buy car okay for example Mazda 100,000 plus okay you can buy house ini lah two story 350,000 so okay so at that time you can have meal nasi ayam and drink okay only RM2 okay but now you have this the same meal is already RM8 so this is what we known as inflation maknanya kenaikan harga barang what you get okay sebagai contoh macam roti canai I remember when I was primary school okay roti canai is worth 50 cents at that time okay but nowadays roti canai one roti canai okay berapa sekarang satu keping roti canai
RM10
so kalau if during 30 years ago okay you can buy RM1 you can get two roti canai at that time but now if you have RM1 you can even buy that one roti canai you need RM1.10 to buy one roti canai so it shows inflation kenaikan harga barang so means that it reduce the purchasing power kuasa membeli kita our own purchasing power so this is a working hours okay so this kalau you cakap dekat Malaysia but if you want to compare with other countries okay so this we can compare KL Sydney Tokyo London New York okay so this we can make also comparison the cost of living around the world or even in Malaysia you want to compare city KL JB Kangar Kota Baru kucing, aquatic kinabalu. Okay, they are different. For example, kalau if a teacher, seorang cikgu, okay, bekerja di KL, okay, they might struggle to cope with the cost of living compared to a teacher with the same salary, but work, for example, in Kelantan, in Kota Baru. So maybe their life over there, okay, they are much more comfortable because of the cost of living. Okay, so this is inflation. Okay, explain in 1 minute. So kita boleh tengok.
Let's assume your monthly income were to somehow double. Congratulations. You can now, for the most part, afford to buy 2 times more stuff. But what if the monthly income of everyone else were to also double? Well, in that case, you'd no longer be able to buy 2 times more stuff. Because since everyone else also earns 2 times more, there would be 2 times more money chasing roughly the same number of goods. Let's take things one step further. What if your income doubles, but the income of everyone else triples? In that case, you'd actually become poorer. Why? Because making 2 times more money is not enough to keep up with everyone else, who now makes 3 times more. If there's an overall increase in the price of goods and services of X percent this year, you have to earn at least X percent more than last year to avoid becoming poorer in real terms. History makes the effects of inflation crystal clear. Today, each dollar buys you approximately 39 times less potatoes than 100 years ago, or 20 times less coffee, 24 times less bread, and so on.
Okay, so that is on the basically the definition of the inflation. Okay, so that is okay. So salary increase does not come with a productivity increase, produce pressure on the price. So called overheating. So which is reflected in an increase in the in inflation. So kalau kamu punya gaji naik pun, orang semua gaji naik pun, okay, it won't give you much benefit because the demand also will increase. Okay, so that will result in the higher price of goods and service. So this is inflation, supply and demand. Inflation described as too much money chasing too few goods. So this is simple supply and demand work. If the supply of a product is high, then a lower price will be reflected. So if there is a shortage of product, demand remains high, then the price is expected to rise. So this is applied at the macro level, whereby the, if the supply of a goods and service in the economy is low, the price will rise. If the demand of a good or service is low, the pressure on the price will fall and will be greater. So inflation versus recession. So recession is a slowdown in the overall economic activity, okay, and registered as a drop in GDP. So berlaku pengurangan activity. So people buying less, okay, and productivity less. So it can lead to the recession. Inflation, steady rise in the price of goods and services in the economy over a period of time. So when the price rise, the single unit of currency purchase lesser product or service. Therefore, inflation reflect the purchasing power of one unit of money. So moderate inflation is good for economy as it is associated with the economic growth. Okay, and high inflation, it is sign of a overheated economy. So we need inflation so to reflect the economic growth because means that there is demand. Kalau tak ada demand, harga turun, okay, nobody is going to buy the item. So you need certain little bit of inflation to get the economy running. So okay, so that is inflation. Recession is goes slow. Okay, and okay, among other reasons, inflation is the major cause of recession. Okay, so input cost increase for business, therefore business pull brakes on the production, cut down salary, adopt cost cutting measure. So this is actually what happened now. It is related to with the inflation, but because of the COVID-19, so because economic activities are getting slower, restriction of the movement, so company can run normal, so they have to adopt certain measure. So that's why there are a lot of cases of people lost job or have to take salary half salary, so less money, so it can lead to the recession. So a prolonged pronounced recession is called economic depression. So depression, that is the worst thing could happen. So recession happen when majority people are in the economy reduce spending. So there are various factor. High interest rate, reduced salary, and above all in inflation that caused the recession. So I think we can have a look at this video. Recession.
In your view, what is a recession?
Well, in a recession,
it's economically challenging for people to buy stuff. The economy going down. A recession is when the economy fails to grow for two or more consecutive quarters within a fiscal year. That last one almost got it. Harris, what's your understanding of a recession?
Let's look it up. So it says some economists define a recession as two consecutive quarters of decline in the country's economic growth.
What does that really mean? I'm Willa.
And I'm Harris. Let's get back to basics.
Sometimes a recession is triggered by something that happens with the stock market or in the business world that scares consumers. Something that makes people hang on to their money instead of spending it.
As consumers start buying less stuff, companies have to cut back on their output. And if companies are cutting back on production and not selling as much, eventually they'll have to lay off workers.
Right. And if people are unemployed, they typically stop spending on all but the most essential things, like food and rent. So to determine if a recession is taking place, economists look at personal income, how much money people are taking home in their paycheck, industrial production, how much the country's mines, factories, and utilities are producing, and wholesale and retail sales. If all these numbers are weakening, you're probably in a recession.
So what we really have with the recession is a vicious cycle. As more jobs are lost, people consume less. The less people consume, more jobs are lost.
Now, recessions happen on a regular basis. Some people may wonder why the government doesn't do more to stop them.
Well, recessions do cause pain, but economists think that they're a natural part of the business cycle, like the ebb and flow of the tide. During an expansion, consumer spending is growing, especially for big ticket items. When a recession happens, sales of consumer products begins to fall. Eventually, the recession ends after this activity hits a low point and begins to pick up again. Now, some recessions do last longer than others, particularly those accompanied by financial crises.
So, if people are feeling a lot of pain, the government does have tools it can use to stop a recession, like fiscal policy and monetary policy. Or it can simply let the invisible hand of the market work things out. But how do we really know when a recession has ended?
Well, you'd start to see factory production go up, as companies and consumers start to buy big ticket items again. Eventually, employment would pick up too. And with more people employed, retail sales would go up.
But we don't know exactly in real time when a recession has ended. Economists only know after the fact, when they have all the data.
Well, as far as we're concerned, the recession's over when you all have all your spare cash again.
Okay, so that is on the recession. Okay, so the short video, okay, that described so how does inflation recession affect us? So it stated in the video, reduce purchasing power. So your ability to buy being reduced. Encourage us to spend and invest more. Okay, so when price constantly rising, people tend to buy now rather than later, since money will lose its value. Therefore, during inflation, people tend to buy and stock up things as far as possible. Okay, so consumer fill up their tank, stuff food in the freezer, and buy asset, gold and other precious metal. So this is what happened. For example, COVID during few months ago, okay, the gold spike, spike, but now the value of the gold fall a little bit. Okay, so in Malaysia you can see, okay, some gold jewelry shop full of people buy gold because of the price as fallen down. Okay, business on the other hand make a capital investment. Overall, people tend to invest in inflated economy so that they can earn enough returns to beat inflation according to their saving in the long term. Okay, and this usually happen in the early expansion cycle when inflation is rising due to the lower interest rate. So people are encouraged to spend rather than save. So when inflation hits up, the interest rate rise and the spending reduce as people will encourage to save. So the interest rate is a tool often used by central bank to manage inflation among other thing. So interest rate, okay, normally bank negara, BNM, they will make announcement whether the interest rate is going up or down. So they have to monitor the economic condition and try to suit to the condition in order to make sure that the economy is in the stable condition. So this is how does inflation recession affect us? Okay, increase employment level. Okay, and it's your long-term saving. Okay, and this is the economic cost of unemployment. So unemployment, so inflation, okay, has economic cost. However, arguably the cost of employment are far greater. So these are some of the cost of unemployment, much lower income. Okay, so they will rely on the unemployment benefit. So they will see drastic fall off income. Okay, so bila tak ada kerja, okay, you don't have money, and so there are a lot of issue. Okay, with the loan. Okay, loan, you cannot pay your car, you cannot pay your housing loan. So in some cases, the bank will repossess your car or your house. So that is issue. Psychological cost, so stress, so have problem. So they maybe can lead to marriage problem in the and family issue. Okay, social problem. Okay, so social problem, lot of thing. For example, riot, kerusuhan. Okay, they don't have job. They will blame other. For example, in some country, they will blame the government for failure to look after their welfare. So they will have a riot and destroy all the facilities or the city. So that is the worst case scenario. Okay, higher government borrowing. Okay, because government has to provide benefit, give, for example, money to the people who are unemployed. So they have to find the money, and so it will lead to higher expenditure and negative spiral. Okay, so it's leading to lower growth. Threat of unemployment may be sufficient to reduce spending. Okay, this is the video, and this is the also on our country news. Okay, so output to decline all sector except service. Okay, so this is the example of the report. Okay, so they will specify which sectors are affected. Okay, so inflation, recession, productivity. So this is another additional video. Okay, and this is on the UK. UK economy. So it's also inflation is not only in Malaysia. It's an issue all over the world. So the government. Each of country, they will come up with idea on how to control this inflation issue because it doesn't want to affect the people, their own citizen. So what else cause inflation? Rising house price. Okay, printing more money. So printing more money is not a good idea because if you print more money, it will reduce the value of the money. Eh. So kita print money, it should be on, for example, amount of gold being keep in the country by the government. So berapa jumlah emas yang ada nilai. So you have, for example, 10 billion, for example. Okay, so that is the amount, the money that you need to print. But if you print more money, you will reduce the value. So katalah contoh satu negara tu patut print 10 billion, so contoh. But they print 20 billion. So for example, you have, for example, 50 ringgit. But actually, your money is just worth, for example, 25 ringgit. So it reduce the value. So printing money is not a good idea. So you have to look at the for example goal. Berapa banyak ada dalam sebuah negara before you decide on the money printing. If not, it will end up become like Zimbabwe. So you have a lot of money. For example, dalam satu guni, but it just worth for example 100 ringgit. For example, so that is not good idea. Okay. So this is on the inflation, okay. Thing I will, and this is the business cycle, okay. So a business cycle is a cumulative fluctuation aggregate output that lasts for some time. So a peak is a point, the mark end of economic expansion and the beginning of recession. So benda ni, recession, kemelesetan ekonomi ialah satu benda yang berlaku every 8 to 10 years. Because I remember in 1986, 87, and when I was in primary school, at that time a lot of that time those who graduate from university find it difficult to get a job. So some of them end up taking course to become a teacher. Ramai at that time in 86-87 because of the recession. Okay, they don't have difficult to find a job. So some of them end up being a teacher at that time. So 1997, so there was another recession. Okay, so at that time, also I remember the government has stopped the giving, for example, scholarship to send student study overseas. One way to control the expenditure at that time. So it happened every 8 to 10 years. So okay, so the true marks at the end of the recession is the beginning of the economic recovery. Okay, the time span between troughs and peaks is classified as the expansionary period or a contractionary period. Okay, so no one able to explain why some business cycle are more severe than others. This suggests there are numerous causes that the importance of each cause varies. So when recession happen, okay, certain sectors might not get affected. Okay, but certain sectors might affected the most. So we have to look what are the costs when this happen. Okay, and next we look at the productivity. Productivity refer to the amount of acceptable work employees do each dollar they earn, or the number of certain product manufactured within the given amount of resource. Productivity is used to compare the competitiveness companies and countries. So productivity, for example, if you work, you have two workers, A and B. You ask them to assemble a product. So if workers A produce, for example, 40 units, assemble 40 units, and workers B can assemble, for example, 50 units, 1 hour, you given the same time, so means that workers B is much more productive. So that's the important, how much that you can produce that meet the standard. So that is the productivity. So productivity is used to compare competitiveness of a company and country. So improving productivity, increase amount of output without similar increase inputs or cost. So decrease cost without decreasing the amount of output. So we try to increase the output using the same workers, keeping at the same rate. So that you can reduce the cost per unit. So you produce You pay the workers for 1 hour, for example, RM20 to assemble, but that RM20 workers produce 40, another workers produce 50, but also you pay RM20, so that the cost per unit is lower, for example, in case of workers B, so that is the example. So improve method, way things get done. So I think we have covered this industrial management. Okay, maybe assembly process. Okay, you look at how you assemble. Okay, work study and so on. Reduce overhead. Reduce waste. Lean. Okay, reduce idle time. Physical resource. I think we have covered this. MEN 575. Installing modern equipment. Automation. Okay, minimize tardiness, absenteeism. So absenteeism is a big issue in the industry, especially in the when you work in the factory, with workers absent. So you need to find replacement to do the job. So because they need to meet the demand. So that is the big challenge, absenteeism. And finally, turnover, how many people resign, so on. So improving productivity, employees feel or productivity improvement because many organizations make them by laying off some employees and giving extra work to the remaining employees. So this is a constraint of productivity. Has a limit impact of a supervisor or even higher management. Okay, some of the important constraints on productivity are management limitation, employee attitude skill, government regulation and union rules. So constraint productivity management limitation. Okay, so for employees to contribute to improving productivity, they must believe in management committed to this objective. So they should supervisor should lead good example, demonstrating through action and words that they are interested in the department's productivity. So it should be from the top. So the management should show commitment, should good example, so that the employers will follow. So it's a kepimpinan melalui tahu ladan. So it's start from the top. And this is the constraint of productivity, employee attitudes and skill. Okay, so improving productivity involve making changes. So changes is the most difficult part because a lot of people resist changes. So that's a big issue, but you need to communicate and persuade them to change for the benefit of the organization, okay, and benefit for them self. So that's the how you can do. So you must deal with good communication, okay, and persuade them for changes. Okay, constraint productivity, government regulation. So a lot of issue, law, for example, law on the overtime. Overtime, how many hours you have to work, okay, provision, for example, if you want to employ a disabled person. Okay, and limitation on the pollution, okay, safety standard. Okay, so this issue, or use of child labor. So in certain countries, okay, they exploit the use of labor, child labor, for the job. So these are some of the issues. Okay, constraint productivity, unions rule. Okay, unions, kesatuan. So kesatuan, okay, there are unions that try to protect, protect the employee. So this also, so the union and the management, they need to communicate and come with a conclusion or any decision that will benefit both parties. So that's because normally union when they talk to the management, okay, so they normally they end up in the heated discussion. So that's that's normally the big issue when dealing with the union. Okay, unemployment, labor force. Okay, and okay. So next is the cost of living. Okay, cost of living. Cost kehidupan. So it's one of the issues. In today's is much more challenging. Much more challenging. Okay, and okay, I think when you graduate, you will expose yourself to this issue. Okay, so the cost of living is how much you pay for housing, gas, food, clothing and other everyday item. So it's a measurement that allow you to compare expense between location and over time. And most of the cost of living calculator give you a dollar to for dollar comparison between your location and another. And the cost of living index give you a percentage difference in the cost of living between your location and another. So this is the cost of living. Things that you need to take into consideration are food cost, housing, accommodation, and what type of house you want to live. Is it an apartment? Okay, is it a link house? Transportation cost. So those who are working in KL, okay, normally they will use public transport, LRT, MRT. So you need to consider, okay, how much does it cost? Healthcare. So healthcare, okay, in Malaysia, okay, we have option, either to go to the government or private. So if private, it's better to take insurance. So they will cover for healthcare treatment. Personal care, utility expense, you need to pay, for example, electricity, water, or if you subscribe to internet service, you need to pay that. Child care, education cost. So this is one of the issue. Okay, so when you married and you have children, okay, you have to decide. Okay, if both of you work, husband and wife work, so you need to find a daycare where you can leave your baby. Or if you can afford, you can get maid pembantu rumah. If not, you have to leave it at the daycare, so that also will cost you money. So these are things that you need to consider, cost of living, when you tuju. So this is the belanjawan ku. So I think there is in the notes, just give you the advice on what the allocation of the money, how you should spend. Okay, so I think you can go through this document later. Okay, so it will provide you overview on how to manage money. So because when you work, you will receive your salary, then you have to start to pay pay the loans and food and so on. So you need to plan this what is belanjawan. So I don't think I will go into detail on this. So okay, okay, so it's different. Okay, when you graduate, maybe you are single. Okay, priority is different. Okay, so but if you have commitment to look after your parents, so you need to allocate some of this money from them. When you married without children, okay, your responsibility, especially for male and lelaki, will be much more. So you have to take care of your wife. Okay, and when you have children, okay, so it will be more responsibility. And with two children, okay, so you need more money to support your family. So this is the calculation. Okay, and suggestion budget saving in investing. So this is some of the tips. So I think you should have a 6 month emergency fund rule. So maknanya if anything happen, for example during COVID, so if anybody got being loss of job, so means that they have a 6 month fund to help them to support their life before maybe get another job or plan for their future. So that is 6 month emergency fund rule. But the issue is not most of Malaysian they don't have this 6 month not even 1 month emergency fund rule. So that is a serious issue. So you must save and invest your money to have this emergency fund rule. Okay, and retirement. Okay, retirement. So those who work in the government, they will get pension. Okay, and those who work in the private sector or even in government, they can also choose EPF, Employee Provident Fund. So upon retirement, you will get that money to be used. But also EPF also is a lot of issue because once you retired, most of the people, the money will finish within 5 years of the retirement. So what will happen for the remaining years of their life? So that is also another issue in Malaysia. So you must spend wisely the money. And 10% rule. So that means that you save. For example, your income, salary that you get, 10% you allocate straight for your saving. So that is the 10% rule. Okay, and this is the how much your saving. Lower saving rate. Higher saving rate. So when you are young, normally the saving rate is very difficult to save because you get married and you have children, you keep on need to spend money for your children, then send children to school. Okay, but when your children get grown up, maybe that's the opportunity where you can have some save the money and you retire. Then in Malaysia, life expectancy between 70 to 80. So we must plan for this financially. Okay. So apa yang kamu dapat nampak kat sini? Anybody? Apa yang kamu nampak ni? Any comment?
Kereta lawa.
Kereta lawa lagi?
Kereta besar.
Kereta besar lagi?
Rumah biasa-biasa.
Rumah biasa-biasa. Okay. So I think this also issue lah. Issue nowadays some people they buy fancy car. And some people they have this fancy car and they might neglect their responsibility maybe to the children. So these are some of the issues berkaitan dengan benda ni kereta besar, rumah biasa-biasa. Okay, tak apa tapi do not neglect your responsibility. Ada case some people they have this car but for children they not willing to spend, for example, for the education and so on. So these are some of the issue. So this is the cost of living. We look global the global. Luanda, Angola in Africa is the highest. Hong Kong is quite expensive. Zurich, Switzerland. Singapore Singapore mahal is one of the expensive city in the world. Geneva, Shanghai, Beijing, Seoul South Korea. And Switzerland. I think they should also include Tokyo. Tokyo, New York. So these are also high cost of living. And this is the some of the video. So kita boleh tengok. So when this high cost city, normally there is a wealth gap antara yang kaya dengan yang miskin. So it's not good to have a very huge gap between the rich and the poor, eh, because normally when that happen, the poor will have dissatisfaction, tak puas hati. And maybe they are not happy with the government. They will have not happy with the rich people. So that is where it can happen a lot of social unrest, riot. So this is some of the issue. So maybe boleh tengok satu video. Okay. This is in Hong Kong.
Welcome to the land of the billionaires. Hong Kong now has the highest concentration of ultra-rich people of any city in the world, just overtook New York. But not everyone has won out of this. So that is what we're here to find out. Why is there so much wealth being attracted to the city? But more importantly, what does it mean for everyone else that lives here?
Let's do something that's like a bit different
from last time.
So last time the background was kind of blurred out, right?
Yeah.
Like the focus was on the person.
Like it's here.
It's here.
This is Mabel Moore, Instagram influencer, temporary traffic obstruction, and heir to her family fortune.
Do we have it?
Hey!
Hello.
Nice to finally meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Mark,
here.
I'm Mark. Well, nice to meet you. Nice to meet you. Is this all for social media?
Yeah, it is.
Oh my god, YouTube.
For Instagram.
You put more effort into your social media than anyone else I know.
Yeah, thank you.
Friends are living a life of comparative wealth and status. It's unlike the one you would see in the movie Crazy Rich Asians.
You said you dated a few girls. Like, what's his taste? What's he into?
He actually has an Audi sports car, and this car is more practical because my mom likes to drive her friends around.
Yeah. Okay, so this is the sikit kita tengok on this video, it's about 24 minutes. I think you can have a look after class. You can see the huge gap between the rich and the poor in the city in Hong Kong. And this is the lowest cost of living. So dia kita compare. Tbilisi, Georgia, Managua, Nicaragua, Cape Town, South Africa, Minsk, Belarus, Banjul, Gambia, Skopje, Macedonia, Tunis, Karachi, Pakistan, Windhoek, Namibia and Bishkek, Kyrgyzstan. So this is the lowest. Okay, so cost of living in Malaysia is 38% lower than United States. Okay, rent is Malaysia is 68% lower than in United States. So because of this, that's why a lot of foreigners, they choose for example Malaysia as a second home. So that is because of the cost. But even though this lower, but for us Malaysian, for if in KL is still expensive compared to other city in Malaysia. Okay, government support. So government support, so this is what government give. This is before 2018, they give BRIM, then they can after that BSH, and now Prihatin. So these are the benefit give. So where does the government get the money? Okay, basically it's from the tax. The tax that I pay, you pay. So that's the, they can allocate this money to the people. And this is AKPK, Agency Counseling Pengurusan Kewangan. So those who pengurusan kredit, so those who has issue, financial issue, they can go to AKPK and get advice. They can provide advice. So these are the issue. Lifestyle. So lifestyle is a big issue lah. Kadang-kadang gaji biasa tapi nak bergaya. So this is the issue. Okay, and this is how you can save your money. So planning. So you might change your lifestyle. So for example, those who are smoke, you can start to quit smoke. You should make a lot of try to get quotation. Few quotation before make decision, for example, you want to buy insurance for your car, vehicle, okay, decide, then change, for example, use public transport, maybe it's much cheaper, like mentioned, those who work in KL, yeah, if you want to park a car, okay, maybe it can cost you about RM10 per day, so it is a lot of money, but if you use public transport, is much more, cheaper, okay, and this is infographic, they make comparison, comparison of a different scenario on the repayment of this study loan. So okay, you try to get this can go through. Okay, and this is on the perkahwinan wedding. So okay, maybe a few years time and you will get married. So you have to. Okay. So this is bonus. Okay, so those you need to plan bonus so maybe you can go for holiday, okay, invest some, okay, and this is for children, okay, and try to reduce your debt if possible, okay, and keep it for emergency fund, okay, and year-end sale so maybe take the opportunity to buy during sale this you can get less of the price for the item. So this is the on the school, okay, so this are what you need to look into consideration okay, you need to pay for PIBG, okay, tuition if you want to send your children to tuition, okay, and the needs for your children if you go to school. So depend you can go to government school or private so it's your choice. Okay, and this is for travel. Okay, try to look get the best cheapest deal okay, I think that's what I can give advice. Okay, and this is on the car maintenance. Okay, so the important thing when you talk about your car, okay, try to make sure that you send your car for maintenance according to the schedule so that is the best because if you send your car maintenance schedule you can make sure that you can avoid a major breakdown that will cost you more money so that's for vehicle and this cukupkah simpanan persaraan anda so you need to plan like I mentioned EPF you can get those who work. Maybe you can get maybe $500,000, $1 million, but nowadays a lot of issue. Okay, the money that they withdraw from the PF, they finish within the first 5 years upon their retirement. So that is the issue. Okay, so this is the additional material. Okay, so this is on the percentage. So this is a suggestion. What need to done. So this is more infographic for you. Okay, I think you can go through. Okay, so that's the penting dana kecemasan so to emergency fund. Emergency fund so you must plan. Okay, so the best is for 6 months emergency fund so this is where you can save you can keep your money so you can keep and invest. Okay, so ASB tabung haji. Okay, so fixed deposit, KWSP. Okay, so these are the instrument where you can save and invest. Okay, so this is more infographic. Okay, so this is how you to survive in KL. Okay, so you can go through this infographic. Okay, financial management. Okay, and this is the type of financing. So if you want to buy a house, okay, buy a house. Okay, so this you need to look at. So okay, in some cases you need to put down payment. Okay, then you have to pay the legal fee, stamp duty. Okay, then loan document, stamp duty, loan document, legal fee. So before you get your key. Okay, for example, you buy a house at half million. Okay, okay, you need to spend about 68,000 the entry cost to buy the house. So in some cases, okay, you can withdraw your EPF, KWSP, you can withdraw to make the down payment, down payment. So you can withdraw depending on the amount that in the account. Okay, and this is the children, higher education. So higher education, so it depends where you want to send your children. If public university, okay, the expenditure is not as much as private university, but the most expensive if you decide to send your children overseas. So overseas, mahal. Okay, it will be very expensive. So we need to plan. Okay, so this is where you can save for your children education. SSPM. SSPM is good if you save there, because you can get a tax relief. So when you fill the tax form, so you can get a tax relief if you save it at SSPN. So there are a lot of instruments to save money for your children's education. Okay, and this is the post secondary education this in Canada. Okay, and source of finance, you can have two, internal source, external source. Okay, so this five internal source, owner investment, retained profit, sale of stock, sale of fixed asset, and debt collection. Okay, so this is the internal source. Okay, and external source. So can get from bank loan, overdraft, okay, share issue, leasing, hire purchase, mortgage, government grant. So this you can get and you can fund business and so on. So bank loan, you borrow from bank, okay, at the agreed interest rate. Then you need to make the payment. Okay, so this is a bank overdraft. Okay, external source, additional partner. Okay, so you can have a partnership for business. Okay, share issue. So you can issue share. Okay, this is you can increase the money. Your capital. For your business. Okay, external source. Okay, you can lease. Leasing. Okay, it's like renting and asset. So there's an advantage and disadvantage. Because it can be expensive. Okay, and the asset belong to the finance company. So that's the. Okay, hire purchase. Okay, so method allow business to obtain asset without need to pay large sum up front. So okay, you can have this higher purchase approach. Okay, and mortgage. So mortgage, you loan secured on property. So kamu jaga kamu punya asset. So for example, if you have a land, kamu nak buat business, you jaga tanah, then the bank will give you the money. Then you run the business. So kalau tak dapat, okay, and the property will be repossessed. Maknanya bank will ambil harta yang kamu jagakan. Okay, and also trade credit. Okay, so this also is the source for you to run business. And this government grant. Okay, so government grant, government dia bagi duit. For example, to SME, small media enterprise, to run a business. So you can start a business, establish new, then you don't have to pay. That's the good thing. So government bagi maybe 10,000-15,000 kepada pengusaha. Okay, so they set up the business, run. Okay, but the government you don't need to repair. So maybe they will come have a look and whether or not what they have given is a success or failure. Okay, and disadvantage, not all business are eligible for a grant. So normally grant is for SME, which saya katakan, atau small business where give to this or anybody who want to start business, small business. So factors affecting choice of finance purpose, what you want to use for the money, time period, berapa lama nak ambil. So kalau kamu nak ambil rumah pinjaman, you can take up to 30 years or 70 years age, sama ada tempoh tu 30 tahun atau umur kamu mencapai 70 tahun, contoh nak pinjaman rumah, so you have to decide. And because in Malaysia retirement age is 60, so if you take your loan up to age 70, then you have a remaining 10 years more to pay the loan, so that's something that you need to consider. Okay, amount, okay, how much money that you need, okay, and ownership, size of business, so you have to look for the loan, source of finance. Okay, and this is you need to pay your loan, so you, it's your responsibility. So dalam Islam pun, as a Muslim, okay, in Islam, you have to pay your debt, okay, as what being agreed. So because if you don't pay, you have to pay penalty, okay, and some cases you have to pay the interest rate, so that is will accumulate more money for you to pay later. So this is the OPR and loan, so overnight policy rate, so kalau you tengok over the past 1 year, the bank negara they have reduced the OPR, overnight policy rate, okay, so when this OPR reduced means that the interest rate that you will have to pay also reduce less, so this might impact good thing, so mean that you have more money in your hand, so they can spend to help the economy, so the OPR, so it can reduce or increase, so bank negara will announce every 3 months. Okay, and this is the apps for financial management. There are a lot of apps available, so you can have a look and take and use any app that that suits you. So I won't go detail in it. Okay, ada soalan? Any question? So far, ada soalan ke nak tanya berkaitan dengan engineering economy? Anybody? Ada apa soalan nak tanya? Ada nak tanya?
Tiada.
Clear? Clear. So, okay, I think that's all. Sebab, okay, the first part is on the economy, micro, kemudian we talk about supply demand, kemudian kita tengok pasal berkaitan dengan GDP, okay, dan kita tengok on the taxation, so that's the important. Kemudian the second part basically is on the inflation, so inflation, recession, and also we look at the cost of living, later when you graduate, so you enter into the job market, so that's where you start to have more commitment, when you work, you get married, you decide to buy a house, buy a car, so okay, things commitment will be more, okay, and okay, you will become father when you got married, so yeah, a lot of things that you need to take care of, so okay, it will be a challenging satu kehidupan yang mencabar when you graduate. So I believe you, all of you can will be able boleh you can handle it. So I hope you can be good engineer, and good father or mother, and also you can be a good citizen for Malaysia. So a lot of responsibility you have to take care of, especially once you have graduated. Ada yang nak tanya? Anybody?
Tiada.
Tiada Okay, kejap saya nak check. Takut ada pensyarah lain nak cakap ke. Tak ada Rasa tak ada sini. Dr. Bulan tak ada. Okay. Saya rasa setakat ni saja. Minggu depan mungkin dengan Dr. Ali Dr. Ali kita belajar on this finance finance kewangan So this is on the calculation calculation dia banyak calculation interest rate and so on So lot of this calculation mungkin kena prepare apa dah calculator apa semua kertas ke nak buat pengiraan So Engineering Society chapter 6 minggu depan that's only on the calculation yang lain semua descriptive kena banyak menulis ke and facts Okay, lagi sekali tak ada soalan semua?
Tak ada.
Okay, so kalau tak ada apa, okay, setakat itu saja untuk minggu ni. Kita Okay, Muhammad Zarif. Nak tanya ke Muhammad Zarif? Tiba-tiba ada sir ni. Okay, nak tanya tentang CSR. Apa nak tanya? Kalau boleh cakap-cakap lah. Okay, saya and the group buat event nak melawat Subang Sky Park. Okay, surat kebenaran keluar masuk kampus. Dan beberapa peserta okay. Surat keluar masuk dan masuk kampus pada hari tersebut membenarkan saya dan beberapa peserta program tinggal di college kediaman UiTM Okey mana kamu boleh pergi ke fakulti Boleh pergi ke fakulti Boleh pergi ke fakulti. Siapa jaga dekat college tu? Resident staff ada situ? Ada Kalau tak mau macam ni lah kamu buat satu surat bagi saya sign surat tu. Kemudian kamu jumpa resident staff cakap kata kamu nak kena keluar tarikh sekian-sekian untuk buat program CSR. Okay, boleh tak?
Aku dah nak berak dua kali dah.
Okey Muhammad Zarif. Tolong buat surat Buat surat kemudian kamu grup saya Dr. Wan Mazlina. Ah, kalau kau tak minta dengan Dr. Wan Mazlina. Tak buat surat, kena minta kebenaran untuk keluar lah. Maknanya dia kena ada kebenaran lah untuk kamu keluar dari tempat kamu apa resident lah. Okey. Okey. So kalau ada apa nanti boleh tanyalah. Minta dengan Dr. Bulan ke tanya lagi. Kalau tak apa tanya saya atau ini beri asah. Okey, ada soalan lagi nak tanya? Tak ada eh? Okey, kalau tak ada itu saja eh. So kita jumpa minggu depan eh dengan Dr. Ali eh. Okey, terima kasih semua.
Terima kasih Dr.
Okay, thank you, Dr.